Firstly, I must say that I was a bit taken aback because I was to get out at the entrance, and I was told, no, please take the car through the Rang Bhavan entrance, and then the car was brought all the way here. I felt like I was being told I'm an outsider now. I wasn't allowed to walk through the corridor, but I'll do that on my way out. But yes, it actually feels lovely to be back.
Thank you so much. I now leave it to the speaker head management, Samiha Sabnis, to conduct the interview. Thank you.
Ma'am, I would first of all thank you for coming and doing this for us. It's a huge honor that I get to interview you. And so the first question I will start off with is, first of all, we are extremely proud that you're a sociology graduate and you've been in our department. So has sociology as a discipline helped you in any way throughout your journey as an actor?
Thank you, Samiha, for the welcome. And I keep saying that, you know, sociology is the reason I believe in the possibility of possibilities. Because what sociology taught me is that what is not true for you may be true for someone else, and what is true for you may not be true for someone else. So, you know, therefore, I think because you study about so many societies and cultures, you realize that you have to have an open mind. You can't judge anyone for their practices, for their cultural practices, for their norms and their mores and all of that. And that opens up your mind. And that, as an actor, I think is a very, very useful lesson. So yes, I think sociology has definitely helped me.
So ma'am, the discipline of sociology also comes with a certain ethics of its own, that we see a world from a certain different, say, analytical, critical perspective. And has it ever happened to you? Because we've been discussing this whenever we watch a film.
I'd say I've been very fortunate that I've done work that's in line with my beliefs. But not that I haven't had the opportunity to do other work. You know, but it's a choice I made that I only do work I believe in. For example, for me, even, you know, especially in the past, I think 12 years, I've had the chance to tell stories of women who come into their own, who find their voice, who find their strength. So, you know, even if they start out weak and vulnerable at the beginning, by the end of it, they've come a full circle. So I think those kind of stories I veer towards. I've had the opportunity to do other stuff, but I've chosen not to do it. I've tried dabbling in it for a bit, but I found it absolutely inconsequential. And with no disrespect meant, insipid, you know, which is why I didn't do it. But yes, you know, sometimes when I watch movies also, I'm like, you know, they're not in keeping with my beliefs. But I will say this, that there's been, I've observed that over the years I've matured as a person. So previously it used to be all black and white, you know, but today I've come to understand. I'll give you an example of a film called Kabir Singh. There was huge uproar when Kabir Singh released. People felt that, you know, how can you glorify a character like that of Kabir Singh, because he was absolutely disrespectful, violent towards women. And there was, previously I would have had the same reaction. But today I feel that it's not glorifying it. It's telling the story of a Kabir Singh, and there are enough Kabir Singhs in the world, you know, especially in our country. So I'm okay with that. I make a choice not to be a Kabir Singh. As a person, that choice is mine. But will I not go to the theatre and watch a Kabir Singh? Of course I will. So I think I've also kind of matured. And I have to, you know, interrupt this by saying I'm very thrilled that my professor Vinita Bhatia is here. And I used to do a paper with ma'am called Women in Society. So I'm thrilled that she's here for my talk. And sorry, Pranoti, I got so excited by this entire... you know, Pranoti was actually my junior, and she's head of department today. How cool is that? But that also means I get to publicly bully her. not bully, I'll tease you.
Sorry.
Okay. Sorry for the digression.
No, ma'am, of course. So, because we're on the topic, so there's this always like a chicken and an egg story when it comes to, say, media responsibility. So, according to you, the responsibility of, say, proper representation.
I think, you know, when we talk about audience demand, we have to realize that the audience comprises you and me. We almost talk about the audience like they're, as if they're an alien entity. So what the audience demands come from us. You know, I think as far as we understand that, we'll put out content that is true to us. So like I'm saying, you know, someone will put out a Kabir Singh. Someone else will put out a Mission Mangal. Someone else will put out some other film. So I think gone are the days when you could get away with shoddy content and blame it on par audience ko yehi achhi lagti hai. You know, we're all, I think, very astute and mature today. We know exactly what we want. And because I think it's, of course, a chain reaction, a lot of things have changed around us. So the content has become very varied. There's an audience for every kind of story, for all kinds of content, you know, which is also why you have the OTT platforms today. So it's not just your films, but there are things that you may not go to the theater and watch, which you'll watch on your Netflix, you know, Amazon, your Hotstar, or whatever. So I think it's, and the responsibility, therefore, is also shared responsibility. You know, I think it's not, it's not so much just the responsibility of the makers. It's also what audiences respond to that encourage the makers to go out. It's a two-way process, really. But I think as long as even the makers realize that they're part of an audience, you know, I think there is no issue. But when people begin to think that they're, you know, kingmakers who are bailing out stuff for people to watch, that's where there is the issue of, am I answering you adequately?
Yes, definitely. If,
because sometimes I tend to get so, I talk a lot, so I go all over the place, yeah.
So the next question is, recently there was a debate that I saw, which was talking about like all female-centric films are not necessarily feminist.
Yeah.
So there was this one doubt that came in my head that do men or any other gender, do they have any space in feminist cinema? Can we have a feminist film without a female protagonist?
Wow, that is an absolutely stunning question. I would want that because, you know, male-centric films have always had men. So as a woman and as an actor, I don't want female-centric films not to have women. That's where we hold center stage most often. So I think that's not a scenario I'd like. But it's something, you know, to think about, really. I've never thought about it. You're right that every female-centric film is not a feminist film. But really, what is feminist also needs to be revisited, you know, because I keep saying this, and I'm only saying I keep saying this because, you know, I have the opportunity to travel all over the country and engage with people, and I've realized over time that, you know, what is empowerment, what is feminism really is very, very subjective. It depends on what context you come from. So a certain step I take today may seem like a feminist step, you know, but maybe for a person who comes from a village, maybe the back of beyond somewhere, a smaller step, like I keep saying this, you know, just to lift your ghungat and walk with your head held high may be seen as a feminist step or an empowered step. So really, it has to be contextualized.
Ma'am, on a similar topic, so whenever you've given a certain script, what are the kinds of elements that you are looking for? How do you choose your character?
I think any character that really calls out to me, when you know, when it's being read out or when I'm reading it, if I see myself in the role that's being offered to me, it's great. You know, for the longest time, every time a story was being narrated, I saw myself in the character of the male hero. And I realized that the narrative has to change for us female actors, because, you know, I tended to get attracted to the most powerful role in the story, and I realized it belonged to the men. Thankfully, that narrative is changing, and but it's something that, you know, instinctively calls out to me. It's something that, as an audience, I ask myself, is this something you'd want to go and watch in the theater? You know, is this a story you'd like to tell? Is this a story you'd like to tell being the character that's being offered to you? And then, of course, other considerations come into play. You know, who you're going to be working with, director, producer, how much money they're paying you. All these things matter. But most importantly, I think, I tend to get drawn towards women characters that have a certain arc, who come into their own, who discover something about themselves. Maybe because I'm constantly discovering something about myself, I tend to get drawn to women like that.
So, ma'am, after the selection, as the process goes, we hear words, we don't know really, but from the perspective of, say, characterization, you go through a certain process of research, and this has always bothered me whenever I try to, you know, learn acting as well, that whenever an actor tries to do background research per se for any character, can an actor's personal bias affect their portrayal of certain characters? Do you have to be completely neutral when you approach a character?
You know, that's not humanly possible, because I am me and I'm playing someone else. But I think as you work more and more with more experience, with a certain amount of maturity maybe, you can separate. That happened with me on The Dirty Picture. You know, previously I would have been very judgmental of a person like Silk. She used her body to get ahead in her career, and that was absolutely unacceptable to me. But every time I spent and sat with the director, Milan Luthria, the only thing he'd tell me was, I'd say, you know, tell me about her as a person. Is she impulsive? Does she get angry when she, what angers her? You know, all these questions that I would want to talk to him about it, and he would not give me any answer. He'd just say, you know, if you judge her, everyone will. And remember, if you judge her, she'll end up looking sleazy. If you embrace her, she'll end up looking sexy. And I was like, you know, quotable quote, yes. but I didn't quite get the purport of what he was saying. I think he kept saying it, but when I started doing the film, I actually realized what he meant, because I needed to put myself out there in a way that I had never done before, not even in the confines of my own house, in front of the mirror in my house. I had to be that brazen bodily. And if there was any kind of shame or awkwardness that I felt, it would show in my performance. If it showed in my performance, that's what really differentiates what makes sleazy versus what makes sexy. You can be, you know, really clothed from top to toe, but your attitude can make you sexy. And you can wear clothes to nothing, and you may not end up looking sexy, you may end up looking sleazy. And this is still, I'm talking about appearance, but you know, what you actually put out there is a reflection of what's going inside, which is why I'm using sleazy and sexy for easy adjectives. But I think that The Dirty Picture changed the way I think I looked at women who choose different paths from the way one I did or I do. You know, I think it was fascinating for me, it was liberating for me, it was so freeing. You know, because when you stop judging someone else, actually what you're doing is you stop judging yourself. And I think that is the most beautiful gift that film gave me. So yes, it's very difficult to get rid of bias, but with experience, like I said, you know, It makes you realize in the possibility of possibilities. So yes, this is not who I am. This is who she is. And that doesn't make her wrong. It just makes her different from me.
So ma'am, based on your answer, what I see it as, that every actor...
And you can clap once in a while, actors love it. Wait when I finish an answer.
So yeah, ma'am, like you said, that you go through story to story, you go from character to character, and you almost like you're living multiple lives in just one. So an actor has perhaps an experience in many different spheres, many different lives, and they do research. They, like for you, if we take your example, they do come from academic background. But this is one thing that has bothered me in recent times, is that whenever an actress tries to speak her mind in terms of, say, a social cause or a political opinion per se, I feel like they're not taken that seriously, because from the end of media, you get ye to PR stunt hai, yeah? From the end of media, you get something like, why don't you just do your work? And from the end of us as well, somewhere I feel that, in academia, the knowledge that comes from a person's experience is not considered very clinical enough. So do you think that there should be a middle ground where even actresses are taken seriously?
I just think we should just let people be. And you know, that's, it sounds so simple, but it's a really tall order. I think we're constantly judging each other. You know, I know that there is, I feel it's, on the one hand, there is a pressure, you know, there's lots of trolling of people when they express their views, when they stand up for a cause, they're asked, what is your credibility, why don't you just stick to what you're doing? On the other hand, there is an inverse bullying, where people who don't want to express their views are being bullied into saying something. I think both are equally wrong. I have the right not to, it's a democracy, and a democracy allows me the freedom to open my mouth or keep shut as I please. You know, I don't think anyone should be telling anyone else what to do. I think that's what, and female actors, I think, have been more vocal in a lot of ways. Male actors don't open their mouths at all. No, it is true, you know, which is why we are being told, oh, why don't you stick to what you're doing, and all sorts of things, and, you know, there are being threats issued and all of that. And that's only because they're, you know, threatening the status quo. They're, people are worried that tomorrow, and I'm not just saying men are worried, I'm saying people are worried that tomorrow their daughters, their sisters, their mothers, their wives, their girlfriends, their friends are going to stand up in arms and again question what is happening around them. I think that is where it comes from. It comes from that deep-seated fear that the status quo is being challenged. But I think that whoever wants to express should be able to express. And in the same vein, I'll say that, you know, peaceful protests are something that our constitution allows us. So as long as I'm not being violent, I should be able to say or do whatever, you know, I'm doing. It is my right. It is enshrined in the constitution. And I think we should all just probably, before anything else, actually go through the constitution and see what our rights are. And I mean everyone across the board, not just as citizens, but, you know, everyone in the country must do that.
So ma'am, you also spoke about the web media coming in, and it has been seen as the equalizer, because with web you have a lot of job opportunities being created in media, and not just female actors but also women writers and directors are like coming in large numbers. So do you think working with a female writer or director is in any way different than, say, a
woman? Oh, it is, you know, and I've just had my first experience. I've done a film which is which tells the story of the mathematician, the human computer Shakuntala Devi, which I also shot for in Xavier's, by the way. And that's been written and directed by Anu Menon. So it's my first experience with a female director. And I think it's just, you know, I don't want to make any gender generalizations, but I do think that because women's experiences are probably, every individual's experience is different, but I'm saying women's experiences and men's experiences or their perspective or their, the way they look at the world does tend to differ. So I'd like to see this, what you called, it's been called some kind of an equalizer. I think that I'd like to see happening across the board. I definitely think we've got more writers, directors, technicians in film. They're of course not even 0.1% of the entire industry, but where we didn't have any, we at least have some more. But I think what it's also, women tend to, and again, this may be a generalization, but I think the women's perspectives are a little more nuanced, which is why probably they're finding more opportunities on the digital platforms, which allow you to have a more nuanced narrative. Whereas in film, you need it to be a little more simplistic. But we women, we get called complicated all the time, and I'm using the word nuance. But maybe because of that, we tend to look at the world in a more, I don't know, it's not through the male gaze. Maybe that's all that makes the difference.
Ma'am, on the topic of, say, gender equality or, say, gender neutrality per se, do you think the whole, when we approach Bollywood, even from a sociological lens, we always have this, oh, this is a male gaze versus this is a female-centric cinema. Is it about time that we also create a certain space for those who perhaps don't want to consider themselves male or female? Like, there's no space other than this gender binary.
That will happen. But you know, I remember on Women's Day last year, we were having this conversation. It was a panel discussion about why call women-centric films women-centric films. And I said, what is the problem? You know, when it becomes the norm, we'll stop calling it anyway, but it's not yet the norm. If you stop calling it that, probably it'll just get obliterated under the weight of all the male-centric works that's happening, you know. So let's go out on a limb and call it female. I've been doing female-centric films for the past 12 years. I'm very happy, I'm very proud, and you know, I'd want to continue to do that until it reaches a stage where there are enough number of films where it doesn't matter whose story you're going to see. You just walk into the theater and go to, you know, watch a certain film, and not because it's female-centric or it's a hero-centric film, a male-centric film. You know, that will happen, but as of now, I think we should shy away from it.
So ma'am, this might seem a little random, but because I was on the topic of, you know, new film, female writers and directors, have you ever considered writing?
No.
The next part of the question was, if given a chance, would you have written any character that you have portrayed throughout the journey any differently, or any story any differently?
No, if I had that capability, then, you know, no, not at all. I don't think I have the discipline. It requires a huge amount of discipline to write and to direct. And there are actresses today who are very involved in the process. Like Kangana is very invested in the process, but you know, she's interested and she's got the capability. But I'm just happy, you know, being in front of the camera. No. I don't think so.
Okay. So, from...
I tell very bad jokes also. So even comedies are up for me.
Okay. From the process, from audition to pre-production till post-production distribution, all of these processes that are very, very, say, standardized in Bollywood, do you think any one process that you seem problematic or needs to change or needs to evolve in a...
Oh, marketing. I think it's so boring, it's so done to death. You know, I don't think anyone decides to see a film because of the way the film is being marketed. You know, I remember in 2012 when I did Kahani and I went out with a baby bump. I don't know how many of you have seen it. You must have been in school for all I know. Anna? So, okay. So, you know, I went out. I had just done the Dirty Picture. And what could I have said about the film? Because it's a thriller, you know. I couldn't say anything. I would be giving things away. So I decided that I'm going to wear the baby bump. And I remember my marketing team thinking, you know, she's officially lost it. But I actually not just wore the baby bump. My first event was at Car Station. So I just went out to Car Station and put up a missing posters, you know, missing person posters. And it was a huge success and I started enjoying this because sometimes, you know, people actually thought I was pregnant and would give me a seat where they were not, where they thought I was standing for long and things like that, because I traveled on the metro in Calcutta, I traveled in, it was just such an exciting thing to do, but that was a clutter breaker at that time. But after that, I think since 2000, I don't know, personally for me, no promotional schedule or tour has really excited me since 2012, and that's really unfortunate. I tend to enjoy whatever I do, so I enjoy chatting with people, so I enjoy doing the interviews and all that. But I think there is a lack of interesting ideas, or then we should just stop promoting films, you know, because I think the trailers really do the trick. People decide whether they have to watch the film or not. And also, you know, because we're constantly on social media today, I don't need to go anywhere and promote a film. You can check my social media feed and see what I have to say.
So, I have actually last two questions, but on this topic, I have to share this with you. So, when I got to know about this interview 2 days back, I started panicking because, you know, I was like, let's research. And I just randomly Googled Vidya Balan latest news or something like that. And you know, the most viewed, because you talked about this as a marketing strategy, the most viewed from when Kahani released, it's still rumors of Vidya Balan getting pregnant, you know. And it's just, and once you click on that, it might be a slightly sensitive topic, and forgive me for asking, but once you click on that, you have 10,000 other such videos. And for me, it was just simply slightly even problematic to, also there was this one interview that I had to ask you about, was when somebody asked you whether you were pregnant, and then you had this huge debate about body shaming, because you were like, just because now I'm married, I don't need to suddenly.
Yeah, you know, I thought it was damn cute. I flirted with my husband. I was on stage at an award function, and you know, I got the Best Actress Award again for Kahani, so, and I'd got it previously for Pa. So I turned to my husband and I said, you know, it always works when I get pregnant in a film, so maybe we should, you know, think about that. And guess what? Every paper the day after said I was pregnant. And I'm like, okay, you don't know the English language, because obviously you don't get a joke, and I'm not being elitist or anything, but actually that's what it boils down to. But then I realized that, yeah, every time I walked into a hospital, or, you know, once I was going to see my neighbor, I came out and they said I was pregnant. Then once, and I've never been thin. You know, but sometimes my kurta sticks to my body, you can see my curves. So someone clicked a picture of me with a circle around the stomach and said, oh, she's pregnant. And I was like, I've gotten, Gandhari had 100 children. I've beaten her to it. You know? Not really. Super productive or reproductive. And considering I have nothing to show for all those pregnancies and all these years, I find it, on a more serious note, I used to say all sorts of things to people before. I used to make, you know, jokes about it and say, okay, the next time my husband and I are together, I'll call you so you know when I get pregnant. Because people used to ask me, when are you going to get pregnant? What sort of a question is that? You know, because I think it's a very personal issue. Asking anyone, when are you going to get married? Asking anyone, it's a very Indian thing. But I'm not sure I appreciate it. And especially don't appreciate it when it's on a public platform with a public person. If I'm your auntie and I can ask you, you know, or on a one-on-one, it's still okay. I don't think it is, but I'm saying it's still, that's, then you tell your aunt off or you tell your cousin, sister off or whatever. But I think it's none of anyone's business, you know, and I think people should understand that. People have to respect another person's right to privacy and, you know, that there's that thing and then there's that the other thing is about the weight. I would have people tell me all the time that, oh, you know, you put on so much weight. I remember this particular actor, I walked into a store on my first Diwali after I got married to shop for something excitedly, and this actor comes up to me and she says, oh, so when are you planning to lose weight? I said, whenever you get a brain transplant. That's what I wanted to say. But you know, obviously I didn't say it. And I said, I'm not planning to. She said, oh, why? You were so lovely in Parinita. I said, I have to have something to show for all these years that have gone by. You know, Parinita was 2005, I'm in 2012. You know, how can you, 2013 as a matter of fact. I find these things absolutely ridiculous. I don't appreciate it. When someone says, oh, you've lost weight, I don't say thank you because I'm not taking it as a compliment. How do you know that I wanted to lose weight? You know, I have to tell you about this incident in Delhi. One lady came up to me and said, oh, you've lost weight. So I said, she said, no, really, you've lost weight. I said, and I continued talking to someone. She said, Nini, such care, you've lost weight. So I want to turn and say, and you lost your marbles, honey. Because she couldn't believe I wouldn't say thank you. You know, I have no problem with anyone saying you've lost weight to me or... But, no, I actually have a problem with someone saying you've lost weight to me or you've put on weight. Because I don't... Just because a body is seen, you cannot make judgments on a person's body or appearance. You know, because, and your brain, I keep coming back to that, you know, I say it as a joke, but I mean it. That if you're so small-minded to comment on someone else's weight, I should start commenting on something that's not seen, which is your, you know, I find it ridiculous.
So, coming back to this conference, in a sense, that this conference that we propose, Art Meets Academia, that it was a dream project for all of us since we came here in FI. So, when we suggest that not just filmmakers or, you know, our entertainment industry needs to also look at their content in terms of research, but also research and academia needs to reach out to the audience in a sense of, and through the medium of entertainment and media, that is something that so that is something of a vision that we had in a sense, because we always saw that performing arts has the capacity to kind of, you know, translate this kind of knowledge to a very large audience. That's something that we see it very a dire need today. So according to you, whether A, is this vision even practical, and also is it necessary?
I've not understood your question completely, so if you can elaborate.
I'll try and reframe it. So what we're trying to do here in Art Meets Academia is that the research that we do in humanities, our sociological theories, it's only been limited to that classroom, and we felt that entertainment and art industry has the capacity to get inspiration and portray it in such a way that it reaches out to the masses. That's why performers here have written academic papers that they are presenting through different mediums of performing arts. So do you think on a larger scale this mission is even practically possible?
No, I definitely think that where research is called for across the media, you know, what I mean is whether it's on film or television or wherever, they do the due diligence. should all research be made available through entertainment to, I'm not sure. You know, there is a reason, you know, unless it's of, like you're saying, unless it's being put together in a way which is of interest to, you know, your consumers, to your audience, I feel it's, why make that effort? Why make that effort in terms of, we should be happy doing our research, we should be happy being academicians. And you know, when there is an opportunity, like I said, when there is content being created that requires research, and when there is that opportunity, of course there will be a coming together. But otherwise, I don't see why everything that is being researched needs to be disseminated to a larger audience. I'm not even sure. Today there are other ways to do it also, like your social media, like, you know. But people who are interested will then, for example, if you are putting out some valid information about anthropology, people who are interested will follow you, you know, and will see what you have to say, maybe comment on it, maybe engage with you. But I don't think it's really, I don't think everything that's being researched or studied needs to be, you know, let them pay and get into a college for that. Don't make it so simple for them. Have I answered you adequately? Okay, great.
And for the final question, this question has been, I mean, I've been asked to really ask it, and also it holds a certain personal value to me. So the performers who are here, who have, you know, written an academic paper, who are, they have passion for their subject, they have passion for their art as well. They are trying to balance and mediate between these two worlds. But for sure, there is a certain hesitation when it comes to deciding a career and, you know, entering this industry per se. So do you have any advice for them?
You know, I didn't have a plan B. Yeah. So it was fairly simple for me. I had to make this work. And I think because I didn't have a plan B, it worked for me. Even when the odds were stacked up against me, I'm not your quintessential Hindi film or Indian film heroine. And but I'm sitting in front of you today only because I knew that this is the only thing I wanted to do. So, you know, I feel that, and I may be a bit harsh when I'm saying this, but it takes a lot to follow your heart, you know. And when you want an easy way out, then you say that, no, there's parental pressure, there's something else. And I understand parental pressure. I had a lot of pressure from my mother, particularly. She couldn't believe that, you know, I wanted to pursue a career as an actor, you know. She was appalled, as a matter of fact. I remember her telling me that if your grandfather was alive, he would have none of this. Your dad is just too lenient. Again, look at the how she felt that she couldn't stop me from doing this. Either my grandfather or my father had to do it. Anyway. So I just think that it's, if you really want to pursue a career in the arts, do it. No, if you really want to do it, because sometimes these are fleeting passions. You know, you have to know the difference. You have to also know whether you want to do this because you love doing it or because it's easy fame and money. Because let me tell you, there's nothing called easy fame and money. It's a lot of hard work. And therefore, you have to, and it's equally tough to follow a career in any other profession. You know, except that those trials and tribulations and struggles and challenges are probably not public knowledge. Because we are public personalities, everyone knows about what goes on. You know, our struggles, our failures, our successes are glorified or magnified or amplified. But, you know, it's, but when you're passionate about something, whatever it is, it just becomes easier to go through those challenges, to face up to them, to own them, to embrace them, and to come out with flying colors. So just pay heed to that inner voice. Shut out all the noise.
Thank you so much. Now we would take 2-3 questions from us.
Yeah, yeah, happily, even more. If there are.
Teacher, that hand went up to center.
Can you also mention your name, please?
My name is Sanjana.
Sanjana.
You earlier mentioned about Kabir Singh being a story that anyone might want to go and watch. In line with that, there is often a lot of stigma or a lot of backlash that actors have to face for the kind of roles they pick up. They might have done the roles simply because they appeal to them and it's something different and challenging to them. So what is your take on the fact that sometimes the artist's view of self-progress or to give themselves a challenge is often being suppressed or being subject to criticism due to the social implications or the way people perceive their actions to work?
Yeah, I think it's one should want be able to do whatever one wants to do. It's not, and I'm not talking about an ideal scenario, it's very, very achievable. You know, but I think when we feel a loss of control on our own lives, in our own lives, then we begin to try to control other people. We tell them what to wear, what to eat, what to think. And that's what political parties do. Over time, that's what politics is all about. I tell you what to do, I tell you what is right, I'll give you the life that you've yearned. And I'm not talking about one political party, I'm talking about political parties over the years, across countries, across the world. I think that is extremely, you know, it's ridiculous. I keep saying, you don't want to watch a Kabir Singh, no? Don't go to the theater and watch it. Don't stop someone else from watching it, no? It's as simple as that. And if I feel okay to do a Kabir Singh or to watch a Kabir Singh, I should be able to do it. Who are you to tell me what to do and what not to do? You know, I think this, also social media has slightly dimmed our ability to think for ourselves. So if one person is saying, oh, it's really regressive, suddenly you'll see 100 people saying it's regressive. Maybe they don't know the meaning of regressive also. But suddenly it becomes important. You have to be seen publicly as taking a stand. You know, which has no meaning. Because most often I feel, I keep saying this also, that as actors, we keep getting asked about all sorts of things, whether it's demonetization or CAA or NRC or, you know, anything that happens. Why don't you ask sports people, for example? Why are we actors, you know, firstly, you call us, actors are always, you know, are often, not always, are often referred to as, you know, pretty props, you know, glamorous beings. But when it's convenient, you want us to make comments on things that we're not even aware about. And I'm saying it's not only actors. Today, on social media, your friends also put pressure. There's peer pressure to take a stand on everything, to make a comment on everything. I think it's absolutely shocking, appalling, unnecessary. And it, you should be able to say or do whatever you want, especially in a democracy.
Thank you, ma'am. Can we just ask for other people, please? Sorry.
We'll come back to you, Sanjana.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am.
Hi.
My name is Prasad.
Hi, Prasad.
So, the film industry produces jobs beyond actors. So, for example, do you think the film industry is gender neutral? Because even in the female-centric movies, most of the crew is men. And do you think having women or other gendered people as writers or directors would change the way we make our films?
Having more women, is that what you're saying? I definitely think, like I spoke about, you know, our world view tends to be a bit different. Of course, there are individual differences, but, you know, I do think that as women, we tend to look at the world differently from men. So definitely getting in more women will help in a more, I think it'll be more, I'm not saying versus the point of view of men or anything, it's just a different perspective and it'll be nice to see that on screen. So definitely more representation of women across the board will be a great thing. Thank you.
नीचे नीचे बैठना
Ishwari. So I recently watched Parineeta and Begum Jaan back to back. So I saw a very stark contrast in the character. So Parineeta was someone who was like perceived as perfect in the society, but she had very little control on what happened around her. Whereas Begum Jaan was seen someone as not accepted by society, but a very powerful character. So which character did you prefer, or which character did you find more empowering, or which character were you more comfortable playing?
Both equally, because all these people exist within me, and especially at a time when I did Parineeta, I think I wanted to be seen as that perfect ideal woman who could do no wrong, you know. So I think I tapped into that person in me, someone who will stand by the love of her life even if he, you know, couldn't see her for who she was. Unfortunately, when you're younger, you know, I'm saying unfortunately now in retrospect, but at that time I thought that was a way to be, that you know, you had to, even though your man was being ridiculously, what's the word? You know, his worldview was very myopic. Despite that, she stood by him. But in her context, even her silence was a show of strength. Whereas Begum Jaan came from a very different world. Her background was very different. Her life experiences were very different. So she, like you said, she didn't care about how society perceived her. But in Parineeta, Lolita did. And I think even I did at that time. By the time I had done Begum Jaan, even I didn't care what anyone thought about me. So I think my characters have always been a reflection of my personal state of mind. And I've maybe chosen films that have helped me discover a certain facet of myself through the film, through the character. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you.
I'm really
feeling hungry, yeah? The claps are so weak.
Hi, ma'am. I'm clearly taking advantage of my easy access to the mic, but I'm really sorry.
Yeah, not at all.
So when I was reading up about you, which is how I stumbled upon the sociology and the possibility aspect of it, in your interview with Karan Agarwal in 2011, he mentioned that you are standing along with a Durkheimian point of view. So I wanted to ask you that years have passed now. Are you still standing along with a Durkheimian point of view, or
I don't even know what that means. Sorry.
Or do you relate to any other sociologist personally? From
no, I can't remember what the Durkheimian point of view is.
So literally, when you mention sociology is a possibility of multiple possibilities, this is what Karan Agarwal perceived, that you are standing along a Durkheimian, or you relate to Durkheim more. So I wanted to know that as a sociologist or a sociology major,
that,
do you relate to any...
You know, I don't think I would have said that. I never try to sound intelligent because I don't remember sociologists' names most often.
Okay.
But yeah, I definitely believe in the possibility of possibilities still, if that's what your question is.
I really wanted to know if you relate to any sociologist personally. Like for me, I like Foucault. And now that Karan Agarwal mentioned...
I like him too.
So when I read up about that, I mean, it wasn't Times of India, so I really was curious to know if you have a favorite.
No, I'm sorry.
Thank you, ma'am.
I had my favorite professors, one of them is in the room, but no. Thank you. Yeah. Sorry to have disappointed.
Hello, ma'am.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Piyush.
Hi, Piyush.
I want to ask you a question. You mentioned about listening to your own voice in your heart, and you have been a wonderful example of that throughout your career. But I want to ask you, especially as a teenager or being a college student, was it something you always had, like listening to your own voice or following your own heart, or is it something that you develop over the period of time? Because all of us want to do that, but unfortunately the kind of people we are surrounded with, fortunately or unfortunately, not every time we get to do that.
Yeah.
So how do you become that person?
I have to tell you that I had great encouragement at home to do that. I was always told that do what you want to do, what your heart says you should. And, you know, whatever it is that you do, do it to the best of your abilities. So I definitely think that I have had a very conducive environment for me to listen to my gut instinct. But over the years, what happens is I think all of us have a gut, have an inner voice. We even hear it, but we shut it down. Over the years, I've stopped doing that. So I've also gone through that trajectory where, you know, I've said, no, this is rubbish. This is not the right thing to do. Even though your inner voice is telling you a certain thing, slowly in life, you gain the confidence to pay heed to your inner voice. It doesn't happen overnight. Most people find it difficult to listen to that inner voice. So you have to slowly nurture it, you have to listen to it, and even though, sometimes it's like, I want to reach the stars. I don't know how. Just put it out into the universe. Let the universe figure out how you're going to reach the stars. You know what I mean? So I definitely think that it's not easy, but work at listening to your inner voice.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Guys, last question. Someone from this side.
I'm happy to take a couple unless you're near this
way. Sure. Yes. We can take last two, three maybe. Hello, ma'am.
Hi.
I'm here.
Yeah, hi.
My name is Anuja.
Hi, Anuja.
I have a very straightforward question. How do you see Bollywood in next 10 or 15 years? Like, as compared to male and female, how do you look Bollywood or Indian cinema in next 10 years or 20 years?
You know, I think that there's going to be far more female-centric content that comes out and interesting, exciting, engaging female content that's going to do very well and therefore will encourage more of that, you know, because only when something does well do you get the finance for that, and it's the cycle just perpetuates. I think the men definitely need to redefine or reinvent themselves. But I think that generally, content in India is becoming more varied. It's like, the horizon has widened. The scope of the stories, the kinds of treatment that are being used to tell the stories are all very, very expansive today. And therefore more universal, I think. So I definitely think that, and we're one industry, and I'm talking about across the world, where despite the success of Hollywood films, it hasn't dented the potential of our own cinema. You know, we are one of the few countries who can boast of an extremely thriving and successful film industry. And now the good thing is that we're not just talking about Hindi films. You know, slowly the other Indian language films are also gaining popularity. So I think we have so much diverse content to offer that in the next 10 years, I think it's going to explode and take over the world. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, sir, that girl. Oh, sorry, ma'am. Next.
Hello, ma'am. My name is Saloni.
Hi, Saloni.
Hello. So, ma'am, I wanted to ask about, with the amount of fame that you get as a successful actor, you also have a responsibility towards the society and also a kind of protection that you have, like a kind of duty to protect yourself also, because you're exposed to a lot of judgments and comments from a huge population. So, for example, right now, like she asked you about your interview in 2011. So do you think that, yes, obviously that you have to be careful with what you say on various platforms, but do you think that somewhere curbs your freedom of speech and expression? Also, I would also want to ask, what is your definition of feminism, and what has it, like, you know, changed, or are there any other elements that have been added over the period of time with the different kind of movies that you've done? Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, I forgot the first part of your question.
It was that, you know, with the amount of judgments and comments that
correct.
You get, yeah, the freedom
yeah.
of speech and expression is that.
Yeah,
so?
I think, you know, I've never cared about that. I'll say exactly what I want to say, and yet I will not say what I don't want to. That's also freedom of speech. You know, I cannot say this enough, because I think there is an atmosphere of inverse bullying at this time. It's not just, I can encourage you to speak, but if you don't want to speak, I have to be able to respect that. So, you know, I honestly feel that I have never cared about what is being expected of me. If you're expecting me to say something, and if you're going to judge me for it, too bad. And if actually, even if you're judging me, I'm not aware of it, because I don't read comments on social media, I don't read the newspapers, I don't watch TV, I don't listen to the radio, only to preserve my sanity. Because, you know, I really think that if I have to listen to my own voice, you have to cut out the noise. And like he was saying, you know, we keep thinking about what others are going to say, because you're being constantly judged. If I begin to look at myself through the prism of, you know, others' judgments, then I'll probably be schizophrenic. You know, because I'll be confused about who I am. So I've retained my sanity only by being mean to myself. Was there another part to that question that I'm missing?
No, that was the second question altogether.
Okay, the feminism part.
Yeah.
For me, feminism is to be in love with yourself. It's a very simple definition. To be in love with yourself as a woman, and whatever that means, therefore.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a distinction for somebody like you? I don't know whether you've worked with female directors, but is there a buzz about how it's different when you work with female directors rather than working with male directors?
I just worked with a female director, Anu Menon on Shakuntala. She's a writer-director. We also had a female cinematographer, again, a first for me, Keiko Nakahara. And it was a female-heavy crew. And I will say this, the only difference I saw was efficiency was the same. You know, it was passions were running high, you know, because everyone, there's so much pressure all the time and people want to deliver. And I think women do feel that need to prove themselves a little more. So you end up working a little harder. One thing that was missing was egos. I think it was a truly collaborative process. You know, that is the one thing I'd say was different and refreshing for me. Yes. Sorry, are you okay with me taking more questions?
One or two more.
Okay. I don't know whoever the mic goes to.
A very good evening.
Good evening.
Name is Achal.
Hi, Achal.
So, my question is not really related to anthropology or sociology.
Thank God.
I just took the opportunity. So, as you were saying that for the promotional event of Kahani, you went around posting missing pictures and people actually gave you seats, seeing that you apparently. But then, it's hard to believe that you were roaming around so freely in a place like India where there are, you know, paparazzi all around, and then there are normal people like that.
That's a myth.
Is it a myth?
You
that's
know, only
that's
Bombay has paparazzi.
That's where my question was coming.
Yeah,
so
you know, not
actually
the other
true?
Cities. And in 2012, we didn't have paparazzi even in Bombay. Like, you know, we weren't being followed outside the salon, outside the airport, outside the hospital. You didn't have them everywhere, so you could get away with it. Of course, course, people at the station recognized me and all that, and I enjoyed that. And I told them, you know, for the camera, I said, dekho, mera pati missing. And they were all laughing because they said, they knew I was doing a film promotion. But the idea is that they realized there was a film called Kahani releasing on the 9th of March that year. So that is the idea of a promotion, you know, whatever tactic you use just to get people. At that point, that was all that was needed. But so much has changed in the past 7 years. Today, you know, I think it's... I don't have anything to say. I don't want to dissuade any of you from becoming actors.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. One last question.
And yet I have to say that, you know, I go to the theatre once a week. Almost every week. In Bombay, people are very chill, they're very respectful. The only thing that irritates me is that, you know, today people pull out their phones. Sometimes you go to use the washroom, there's a person standing outside the loo and saying, can I take a picture? And I'm like, sure, you want to take it of the pot? You know, because just, you know, some
yeah,
semblance
even
of...
Now, when you were talking about how they didn't allow you to walk down the foyer and the area...
No, I think they were just being protected.
Yeah, but do you like feel burdened that way?
No, I don't.
No, right?
I don't. Actually, I chose this. You know, I love the fact that people recognize me, that they give me love and attention.
Yeah.
And I'd be lying if I said it bothers me. But the selfie bit bothers me because people also put their hands on you and all. And I'm not... You know, I'm a public figure, not literally. Yeah.
Ma'am, we can take one last question.
Sure. She's already stood up with me. So.
Hello, ma'am. My name is Trisha.
Hi, Trisha.
So, ma'am, you've been in this industry for quite a long time. And even today, when you go on a set, on a new film set, and it's the first day, do you have that nervous energy, those butterflies, that self-doubt whether you'll be able to do it, and how do you overcome it?
I think there's always nervousness. You know, there's nervousness, there's irritation, there's... I always hope that the film gets pushed by a week. The shoot gets pushed by a week. And now my manager knows that this is... I keep saying, no, you know, I won't be ready, I won't be... I keep giving her all sorts of excuses. Previously, she used to go and speak to the producers. Now she knows that jitna time mile mere liye kam hai. So she stopped doing that. But I think of course this. Because you're going to live the life of another person. You know, until you actually start doing the scenes, it takes a few days. You don't know, you don't have a hang of that person. You know, and then suddenly there are things that you realize during the process of the shoot about that person, about yourself. It's a very, very immersive process. It's highly thrilling and very, very enjoyable. I thrive on it. But yeah, it makes me very nervous.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Yes, one last question. You can use this. Okay. Wow, it's a lovely film, but you know, she did it so well, Nimrat Kaur, I can't imagine myself in it. You know, that's what happens with a good performance, you feel that, oh, actually, I feel like Nimrat must be like that, but I know Nimrat personally, and I know she's not like that, which is why she's so wonderful in the film. I've never regretted any decision I've made. I literally believe daane daane pe likha hai khane wale ka naam. You know, thankfully, I regretted, you know, there was a film that was offered to me that I didn't do, and then it didn't get made. Then years later, they made it with another set of actors. Obviously, this was offered to me when I was new. So years later, they made it with someone else, and there was a lovely song in it that went to her, obviously, because she was in the film. And that, I wanted that song to be picturized with me. That was the only time, perhaps. It was a song called Montare from the film Lutera. And because I'm so fond of Sonakshi, and I know her well, I told her that. I said, that's the only time, you know, I felt envious of someone, because that's such a beautiful song. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, ma'am, with that, we come to an end of this session. Before I pass this to Durga, I just wanted to end on this note. I just wanted to share a very small anecdote with you. Because you were mentioning in that room that you've come here to shoot. And so we were rehearsing. It was, I remember it was a Sunday, and we were rehearsing for a play. And the entire cast saw you in one or the other corridor. And I just couldn't see you. Like, I just couldn't spot you. And we were running around. And I remember me saying that, you know, if she ever comes in front of me, she's the only person who would probably make me faint, you know.
And see how I just revived you.
So yesterday, literally, when we were doing briefings, there was one situation given what happens if Samia faints on stage. Not kidding. So in a sense that I just wanted to end on this note that you're an inspiration to me, to all of us, to many of us here. And you give me hope and you motivate me. And thank you so much for just, you know, being yourself. And I hope you keep breaking more stereotypes and wish you all the successes.
Thank you so much, Samia.